This video is going to be a little bit different than the normal vlog. I review an entire stream session that I played at Champions in Houston, Texas with a good friend of mine. My friend's a very solid poker player. He plays almost exclusively online, crushing 200 and L plus games. I value his opinion, so we'll see what he says. I still might make a regular vlog out of this session because there was a ton of notable hands, but let me know how you guys like this format and if I should do this in the future. Enjoy. All right, we're going to do a quick review session. I'm here with a good friend, Ed, an absolute online crusher. How are you doing today, Ed?
I'm all right, thank you. And yeah, thank you for having me. Yeah, looking forward to looking at some hands.
Yeah, I appreciate you coming out here to roast me.
Not at all. Not at all.
All right, so this is the first notable hand of the session. J-Phil opens up the button with queen six suited, and I look down at jack six suited in the big blind. I don't think there's too much to say here. I think pretty standard defend versus a button opening range. And we go to the flop, which is the king of clubs, four of diamonds, king of hearts. I think he's going to be... We talked about this a little bit, but he's going to be range betting these boards a very high percentage of the time. But I'm going to have a lot of king X as well. But obviously, I have like a lot of junk that just like snap folds. So it goes check, check. And we go to the turn, which is the queen of clubs. And I think this is a card that I probably want to be using large sizes on primarily, as I am going to have a lot of those king X combos. And I'm going to have a decent amount of draws. Whether it's club draws or hands like jack 10, 10, 9. So I think an overbet sizing makes the most sense.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's really good. It's kind of an interesting spot already, isn't it? Because as you said, he's not really supposed to have a checking range in theory, which means we get to go straight into exploitative thinking. And yeah, I imagine his checking range is probably just a lot of weak showdown kind of stuff. And it's just interesting to see that he can have this kind of hand. Yeah, so if we expect him to have lots of weak showdown kind of stuff, like, I don't know, ace high, and it's interesting to see as complete air like this. Overbet seems good in theory and in practice, particularly with the equity of a flush draw.
So I do go for an overbet size. Oh no, I don't. I go for a large size, sorry, 35. So I think I should have used an overbet size here, but I think large size is probably fine in general.
I agree. I think, yeah, massive to go massive.
Yeah, and then river is the ace of hearts. I think this one I definitely should be overbetting. I'm going to have a lot of the king X combos here and some jack 10. So I have a pretty strong value range. And then I'm obviously going to have some bluffs. So some of the missed clubs will bluff. Obviously not all of them, because don't really want to be bluffing with clubs as often because I block some of the folding range. But definitely hands like 10-9.
I mean, I like it. I think this is probably the worst card in the deck in terms of probably for bluffing for us. Just because I think his range is so weak, but he will probably have jack 10 here sometimes, and he might have hands like ace, jack, ace 10. So this probably does uncap him more than we'd expect. If this was like a 7 or 9 river, or 8 river rather, I think we just want to be going for it.
Yeah, but I don't think he has like too much ace X. I mean, it's really just that ace, jack, ace 10 that decided not to bet flop, and then the ace X of clubs.
Ace of clubs. Yeah, that's true. That's true. So what do we think? Do we think he has like a lot of 4X, pocket fives, that kind of the odd spiked queen?
Yeah, I would say primarily some pocket pairs, some 4X, although some of the 4X and some of the pocket pairs are going to be betting flop, even if he's not range betting, just for denial. So I think a lot of it is going to be those queen X combos as well. So, I mean, like, he could have as strong as ace queen, I guess, but I would expect more of like a little bit of queen jack, queen 10, and some of the weaker suited queens, queen 9, queen 8. Queen 6 is a little bit wider than I'd expect, but...
Yeah, I mean, I'd agree with all of that. I mean, even though I think it's probably one of the worst ones to bluff, I still just think we should be bluffing everything because... he's just going to be so devoid of... Well, he's going to have basically no King X, I expect, in practice.
Yeah, I don't think he has much King X. And then top of his range is, for the most part, going to be some of the... Obviously, some of the Jack 10, but mostly Ace X. So I think it's a pretty difficult spot for him in general. I do block the Jack 10 as well. Obviously, I don't want to have the clubs as often. But I think having one of the lower clubs, it's more often that he has some of those flush draws too. So some of those, like, you know, 10 high flushes, something like 9-8 of clubs, something like that.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I think any time where you've got like a pretty wide credible value range, which you do because you have loads of King X, and then he's going to have a lot of bluff catchers that aren't going to like facing big overbets. Overbetting seems good. So yeah, I like the hand.
Yeah,
not worried too much that we're bluffing clubs. Yeah, I think it's fine. I like the hand.
So we do get that one through.
Good start to the session.
Yeah, for sure. I think this might have been the next hand, actually. So J-Phil opens again, this time on the cutoff to $35. I look down at king queen offsuit in the small blind. I think this is a hand that I really just want to be three betting here almost every time. It's going to have a pretty wide cutoff range, and I don't really want to be flatting an offsuit king with the two blinds behind me.
Yeah, love it.
And he continues. Go to the flop, which is the 5-7 jack rainbow. Pretty indifferent on betting this combo, I guess. maybe lean towards betting slightly, just folding out some of those ace-x combos and stuff. Obviously, I can pick up a lot of equity on straightening cards such as the 9, 10, or ace. And then obviously a king or a queen are good most of the time.
I have a big preference for betting. I've got nothing to add from what you say. I imagine, I mean, in theory, if you like bet half pot or a big bet, then he'll have to do a lot of defending with his ace-x, which, I mean, I'm not that familiar with these games, but I'm just guessing that people will struggle to do against big sizes. Like you say, there's lots of cards that you can pick up equity on the turn to barrel further. So yeah, I would probably just bet this hand always. Seems good.
Yeah. Do you prefer small size or large size here?
I mean, I would go at least half pot, I think. I think anything at least half pot, I think.
Yeah, I think I went smaller, but I think like, yeah, maybe a little bit larger makes sense to apply pressure to some of those ace-x combos.
Yeah, I think if you go smaller, then you've got to be like, which is, I mean, I think, I imagine this is not that we need to be getting into theory, but I imagine this is a spot that if you put it into a solver, that it'd be like, it would use lots of sizes. If you gave it like a third half pot big, it would like use all of them.
Yeah, I think any size is honestly fine for the most part, but.
I agree. I think if you want to go smaller, though, you want to definitely be very aggressive on later streets. So yeah, take advantage of his wider range. I don't think it matters too much.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. It's kind of like a weird board texture. I feel like if it was like a little bit higher, like a jack 10-5 or something like that, I want to lean towards smaller. And if the jack was like a little bit lower, like a 9 or an 8 or something, I'd lean towards going a little bit bigger. So I feel like I'm kind of in between here.
Yeah, probably where it just doesn't matter, like you say, too much.
I believe I do go small here, though, probably about 100.
If you go 100. Small and he folds, then small is definitely the right size.
Sure. Yeah, he does make the call. And the turn is the queen, which seems like a very good time. Seems like a very good card at the time. I probably do barrel this card most of the time. I know we've talked about this in the past, trying to add a little bit more of the bet check line into our three betting. So I've been trying to add that in a little bit. So I think that was part of the reason that I checked here. But I do think this is a card that I probably want to be barreling a high frequency. I'm going to have those like overcard bluffs like the ace king and stuff like ace 10, stuff like that. Obviously, I connect with the queen a decent amount. And then it just applies a lot of pressure versus his weaker pairs and jack x.
So I think this depends a lot. I don't know anything about your opponent on...
Sure.
And essentially your opponent, I think the standard will be to bet your hand like always, I think, right? Would you say? But the wider you think he is pre-flop, and therefore the more air he has in his range, the better and better check gets, I think. So I don't, and the fact that you bet smaller as well, like for example, I think if you bet big, then I think really you want to be betting this hand on the turn. But I think probably it's probably quite a nice thing about the fact you bet smaller, that you've got, he's probably got quite a wide range here. He'll probably still have hands like king nine of, I don't know, diamonds or something.
Yeah.
I mean, that's probably a reasonable barrel, but that kind of stuff. So yeah, I don't hate check, particularly if you think that he's going to defend quite wide to your three bet. Seems fine.
And surprisingly, he checks back here. I think when he checks back here, I expect him to have a lot of those weaker pairs. So maybe some jack X here, but a lot of pocket pairs and stuff like 7X. So pocket eights, pocket nines, pocket sixes, 8-7, that style of hand.
Agreed. Yeah. Very surprised to see he has the hand that he does.
He could definitely could be checking back some of his weaker pocket pairs and ace-x here as well. But it feels like if he did float the flop, at least with some of the ace-x combos, let's say if he did have something like the ace-six of clubs or something like that, ace-six of hearts, I think he would be betting those hands a lot here.
Yeah, I think so.
Surprised to see him check back here. And I think I have a pretty clear value bet here. I think it's pretty unlikely he has too many flush combos as he would be betting the turn here a lot. A lot of those club combos are going to have a pair here or be a very strong club combo. So it'd be like the ace-x of clubs or something like 10-9 of clubs. So I think a lot of those are betting here. Sorry, betting on the turn. So I think I have a pretty clear value bet here. Just trying to get value from his jack-x and weaker pairs.
Agreed. Yeah, I think so. I think, yeah, betting this hand every time seems good. What do you think about sizing?
Sizing, I think I want to go large for the most part, especially after checking back on the turn. I think my hand strength is a little bit disguised here.
Yeah, and because our assumption is that he's going to bet, I mean, obviously this is proved wrong, but our assumption would be that he's going to bet better hands on the turn and bet a lot of his flush draws. So like, we've almost got more equity here than him than we would do in theory, where we'd have to be checking back a lot of flush draws and have more slow plays.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, seems good.
Continue for 350, I believe. I mean, he just makes the call. So.
Yeah.
I think I'm pretty confident I have it, even with the snap call, but it didn't work out for me. Yeah, I think his hand's just a call here, the specific run out here. And I have some stronger hands than ace-queen. I don't think he can really raise here too often with the flush draw coming in either.
Definitely, he has a call. If you block, I think he has a raise, but yeah, against this size, I think he just has a standard call, which he made.
Yeah,
It seems
so
like a pretty reasonable hand from both players. I don't hate his check back on the turn either.
unfortunate that he has ace queen, but could have been worse if I barreled turn possibly or bet larger on
Yeah.
flop. So
I think it's just pretty reasonable hand, both players.
yeah. All right, so this is the next hand. Mo opens ace jack offsuit in the cutoff. I have ace eight in the big blind. I think this is kind of on the edge. I try not to call too many of these offsuit suited combos. I think Mo's a little bit wide. Obviously, we see he's pretty strong here. But I think call's perfectly fine, especially when we're this
Agreed.
deep.
Yeah. It's fun to play parts, right?
Yeah, for sure. We're gonna go heads up to this flop, and I do flop middle pair on the eight of hearts, two of spades, king of spades. And I think I just have a pretty standard check call if I face a bet.
Yeah, unless he overbets, which I imagine he won't, which he didn't. Yeah, seems good. So far, so standard.
Turn's kind of an interesting one as the ace of spades peels off, giving me two pair, but bringing in the flush. He does check back. I would expect him to be barreling most of his made flushes here, as well as his hands, like let's say queen jack offsuit with a spade. Maybe he's checking back some of his weaker pairs with a spade, but I think a lot of his unpaired spades are going to be betting here.
100%. Yeah, very important point. Yeah.
And I think it makes sense that he checks back when he does hit top pair here when the flush comes in as well at a pretty high frequency. Maybe some of his stronger ace x can bet here at some frequency. I think his ace x with the spade is definitely barreling here a lot. Stuff like ace king. But for the most part, I expect him to have weaker pairs here or ace slash king x combos.
Yeah, I mean, I've got nothing really to add to your analysis. I guess the points I'd highlight, the 2 points you'd make, is that we expect if he's got a single spade hand, or that becomes very relevant on that river, that he's going to barrel it on the turn a lot.
Yeah, so
So what
the
do you think
river
here?
is the seven of spades. I'm bringing the four flush out there. And yeah, it goes back to the turn. Like I said, I think he's going to barrel a lot of those spade combos. I guess he's probably range betting this board, but it's like realistically, he only has something like tens, nines with a spade. It feels like a lot of those style of hands,
Yeah.
maybe 8x of spades as well. But for the most part, I think he's going to primarily have those ace x combos, I think makes a lot of sense, and some king x combos.
And a lot of air.
And a lot of air, yeah.
Yeah, agreed. So I think we should check, right? Given that range.
You would think so, but I'm very greedy. I think he just has a lot of those ace x combos, and I decided to go for a block bet here. Maybe a little bit thin.
Fair enough. But yeah, I mean, I don't think it's so. For what it's worth, I don't think it's too thin. I think that you've got loads and loads and loads of equity. You've probably got, given what we said about your spade region, you've probably got the equity to, like, you could even bet like half pot. But I would be tempted to check to sort of exploit that massive air region and the fact that we just don't think that he has flushes. I mean, obviously with the hand that he has, the line
Yeah,
you've taken is
I guess
better.
I'm not sure how wide the air region is, because I think if he does have something like Queen Jack, Jack 10, I think he does barrel some of those hands
Fair
turn.
enough, I
But I
suppose, from
think
the
it is a
cutoff.
little bit more weighted towards like Ace X here.
King
Obviously, I
X, yeah.
blocked that Ace X and King X.
Yeah, I'm sold. Yeah, maybe versus the button where he's going to have more hands like Jack 8, or well, not Jack 8, sort of like Jack 7 suited, that kind of stuff, Queen 5 suited. Yeah, maybe versus from the cutoff. But you did say he was quite wide. So I guess that's probably what it comes down to. But yeah, I mean, your hand is definitely, like I say, I wasn't saying I think you should check because your hand isn't strong enough. It's definitely strong enough. It's just how we weigh up, I guess, that air region versus the ace x. Yeah, I've actually changed my mind. I think you're right, because I think even with an air hand, even if he did have a hand like Queen 9 of diamonds, like, it's so tempting for people to barrel that, like, that ace on the turn, isn't it? Like that quote unquote scare card. And that's so tempting for players. So maybe he is just, like, yeah, like you said, massively weighted towards sort of middling showdown value. So yeah, change of mind. I agree. I like your line. Good hand that, pocket jacks.
Yeah, and this is like a few hands later, so we're getting a lot of good hands early on. JFL opens this one up again in the hijack this time, and I'm gonna three bet him once again. This time I actually have a premium. I'm surprised to see him call this specific hand, but I have three bet him like, or at least been aggressive multiple times throughout the session. We had the jack six already and the king.
Makes your check with King Queen even better on the previous hand if we think
Yeah.
he's going to defend quite wide.
And then I don't think there's too much to say on this one.
Just bet third.
Yeah, I think just continuing for a third, probably a range bet. I mean, if not a very high frequency bet.
Yeah, it's definitely range bet. Probably could even size up a little bit to half, but I would probably just bet third every time. I love Bobby Jones's look. It's just a great look.
Yeah, Bobby Jones doesn't mess around.
No, I'm a fan.
Cool. So I open this one from early position to $20, gauge 3-bet. And then Bobby Jones decides to call pocket sevens behind.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I was just going to ask what you think the best approach is from Gage's position here. Like, would you have a flatting range with some hands? It doesn't feel like King Queen off would be the best, but what about a hand like pocket sevens, pocket eights? Would you consider flatting there?
Yeah, I think when we're this deep, I think a flat's perfectly fine. I guess in theory, you're probably folding those a little bit more. I don't think he wants to be three betting as wide either as I'm opening from under the gun. So yeah, I think calling some of the probably suited broadways and pocket pairs is probably fine. I guess it depends a little bit on how often he thinks people from behind are three betting as well, though.
Yeah, agreed.
So he does three bet and Bobby Jones calls in the hijack and it gets back around to me. I don't think I want to be continuing this hand as a call, especially multi-way. These offsuit combos don't play particularly well, especially out of position. I do have blockers, so I think I want to be either folding or four betting this hand for the most part.
Yeah, I mean it's probably just a fold, but I can get behind 4-bet for sure, particularly if you
Sure,
think they're
probably
both
lean
too
towards
wide.
fold most of the time, yeah.
What do you think the best sizing to 4-bet? I assume you 4-bet that we're not just going to watch you fold.
Yeah, I do four bet. I think something about like close to 4x is probably fine.
I'd
Maybe
agree with
four and a
it.
half. He's not particularly deep. So let's see, 60. Yeah. So I go just shy of 4x. I don't think in general you have to use massive sizes when you're four betting. I guess I'm not particularly deep either. So yeah, I think the size
Yeah,
is fine.
this size seems good.
I would expect to see folds from his specific hand, but he does call. And then I think once he calls, I think, Bobby Jones is just going to be calling his pocket pairs here.
Yeah, if you got one fold, you'd probably got two. A few notches too wide from Gage, but there we are.
Yeah, like King Queen suited, I think engage a spot. I'd probably continue, but the King Queen off suit, especially with a player behind, I'm probably just folding. But
Yeah, it's just dominated way too much.
we hit a pair. Not my
We
favorite
hit.
pair in the world, but there's a
Yeah,
pair.
check seems good three ways as well.
I think if we were heads up, I'd probably just be continuing here for a small size. But yeah, I think multi-way probably just checking here with middle pair.
Yeah, but enemy units got quite a lot of Jack X and better hands in there.
Right. So Gage actually uses a pretty interesting sizing here, especially given the stack to pot ratio, and he goes for about 450. And
What do
I
we
think,
think about that?
I mean, I don't think I'm typically using that size in his shoes. From my perspective facing this, it feels very much like a very strong hand or a bluff. Obviously, his bluffs have a lot of equity. So I thought about it for a little bit. I wasn't sure if he had the offsuit combos as much. I do block hands like pocket tens, which I think make more sense to use a large size here, and then hands like ace jack. So for the most part, oh, sorry, and I block jack 10 suited. I think for the most part, the sizing is going to be hands like ace jack, king jack. Not sure if he's going as wide as like something like Jack nine. But yeah, I mean, I do block a lot of that range. That's kind of a weird spot. Obviously, I think if I do call here, I probably just have to like go with my hand. I guess maybe call is even not the correct play. Maybe I should just be shoving if I decide to go with my hand, because I don't really know if he's folding hands like king queen, ace queen at this point. 9-8. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean it's super weird because I mean he's left himself literally 500 behind, hasn't he? So I mean my thoughts are that this sizing means something. Like there's no way that he is building a strategy saying, "Well, this is my size here, and I'm going to build a range of hands around it." It's like it's clearly when you use this size, it's like he's got a specific hand and specific things that he wants to achieve.
Right.
And ultimately, I come down this on the same as you. Apart from, I would probably exclude some of the top hands of his range. I would be quite surprised if this was pocket tens or jack ten suited, for instance. I would expect it to be much more like you said, the ace jack, the king jack, or like
Yeah.
a high equity draw. And the only high equity draw, I mean, we've got the benefit of seeing his cards, but would be hands like king queen, maybe 9-8 suited. And then you're just in a really, really tricky spot given the stack to ratio. Yeah, I don't even know whether it's, I don't know, it's so tricky. I might be tempted to fold, yeah, and then I'm just trying to work out what I don't know. I think you're in a really, really tough spot, and I don't know what's best, to be honest. I'm almost hesitant to give an opinion.
Yeah, so super weird spot. Obviously, I think
Super
if I
weird.
call here, I pretty much have to call off, assuming no particularly bad turn cards. So like I think I can fold like a king or a queen turn, possibly a nine
Yeah.
turn. But yeah, I think most turn cards I kind of just have to go with my hand if I decide to call here.
Yeah, it's super weird. I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I might be tempted to fold, but this is where I don't have enough experience in these games. Maybe continue is better.
Yeah, and I mean, I think fold's probably fine as well, but I don't know. I guess like ultimately it came down to like I was blocking a lot of his value that I think he would be betting this with. So I do decide to make the call. But maybe shove's just better here if I decide to continue again, like I said, just because if he does have a king queen style of hand, he just continues anyways. We roll
It
out the
probably doesn't
equity.
matter because you can't really fold, can you? Probably, I mean, when he's got 5-30 behind, it probably just doesn't matter too much to him call and jam.
Yeah, I guess my thought process was if he did have something like, I don't know, some random ace x suited or something like that, or 8-7, I give him a chance to fold and he might barrel those, but probably doesn't
Yeah.
too often given the stacked pot. So yeah, this does go check check on the turn. I
So what do we
think,
think of his range on the turn
yeah, I
when
think
he checks
we're
back?
really getting towards that like king queen style of hand. I think all of his jack x combos are just going to be barreling here, putting it
Agreed,
in.
100%, 100%.
So at this point, I think it's almost like not impossible, but very unlikely that he has a value hand.
So I was just gonna say, after everything we've said, I really, really hope you press check.
Yeah, because I think he does have those king queen combos. I don't think I really gain value from too much by betting here. It doesn't really make sense for him to have a worse 10x. So I do
No.
check on this river, hoping that he does
Perfect.
just put it in with something like king. I think my range starts to look a little weaker once it goes check, check, but he does check back, unfortunately.
Yeah, I'm glad you checked the river.
So I open up Jack 7 suited in the cutoff, maybe a little bit wide. The button player sitting away though, so I'm essentially on the button.
Seems good.
Gage flats the small blind, Bobby flats the big blind, and Kareem decides to flat the straddle, and we go four ways to the flop.
Almost Houston heads up.
Almost. Needed one or two more people. I mean, not the worst flop for us. I mean, obviously, I do have some pretty reasonable backdoors with the backdoor straight, backdoor flush here, as well as the overcard, but probably just not betting this board too often multi-way.
Yep, like it. Seems good.
Does check to me
Eight
and
of
I check
spades.
back.
Eight of spades.
We'll take a pair.
We'll take a pair.
And Gage leads out here. I think it's fine. I think this is gonna hit him relatively often, this board. Nice lay down by Bobby. I don't think he wants to be calling some of these medium pairs as often with players behind.
Agreed.
But it gets around to me. I think I have a decent seven here. I am in position. The other two players have folded. There's going to be a lot of club draws here. There's going to be some 8x combos here. He could have a weaker value hand that wants to kind of get protection a little bit. So something like the 6-5 maybe. So
Yeah.
yeah, I decided to call once and then just kind of decide on river.
Yeah. Nothing to add.
River is a 6, which does remove some of his value there. He checks and I just quickly check back. Don't think I really want to be betting this card. He's going to be checking some of his 9x here. He could have a stronger 7x combo at some frequency, mostly 9x though. But he's going to have a lot of draws that aren't necessarily calling. I guess I get value possibly from something like 8-7, but I think we're going to see a lot of snap folds in hands that are better than mine. So I think it's a little too thin to probably be betting.
Yeah, you could bet like $10 or something, but yeah, check seems fine.
Yeah.
I do wonder if something like, because he snap checked, right? On the river. He
Yeah,
looked like he
he
checked
does
real
snap check,
fast.
yeah.
So it's kind of, it's weird because he's, you basically never lose, right?
Yeah, that's fair versus a snap check.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe something like you could like bet something like $15, $20. I don't know if that's something you want to do if you're playing with these people a lot, but in a vacuum, I'd probably quite like some like ridiculously tiny bet.
Yeah, I can get behind
Yeah.
that. Obviously, it sucks if I get raised.
Do
So part of me is like, I don't know if it's
you...
worth reopening the action either, but.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah, it's
I mean,
definitely a thought for the future for sure. Trollp opens the hijack to $25 and Michael three bets to $75. So I think Trollp's gonna be opening for the most part any two cards. You'll kind of see it throughout the session on some of the other hands, but extremely wide range. In the past, Michael has been three betting a pretty strong range, but he has seemed to be getting a little bit more out of line and active recently. The other thing too that plays a factor into this hand is we check. I think they both have nit buttons, yes. So we all have nit buttons. So essentially we're incentivized to open hands, three bet, be a little bit more aggressive to try to take down a hand. So I think Michael and Trollp are both going to be slightly wider than they would be normally.
Yeah, what are you going to do? I'm worried I'm bracing myself for the
Bracing yourself. I decide to go with a 4-bet, probably just be folding, not given the Nick game dynamic slash these players' ranges. But I think in this specific spot, a 4-bet makes more sense. And obviously, Michael continues with pocket nines.
So the way it shows on the screen, if in your game, if you have the nit button, I mean, you've got to try and get rid of it, right?
We all get a nit button. You have to win a hand to get rid of your nit button. The last player to have a nit button, I think at this point in the stream, we were saying had to do $200 bounty, just total. And we just do that in the form of a splash pot. After the first one or two nit games this stream, we started doing $300. So, I mean, it's not a massive amount, but it's still significant.
Yeah, makes a difference. I mean, it's 40% of a buy-in, right? If you don't win it.
Yeah, I mean, people are buying in deep, but yeah. Pretty good flop for me.
That's a reasonable flop.
You're going to 4-bet pocket fives. I think this is a board I'm just going to be range betting for a small size. Obviously, I smashed this board, but I think pretty much all my junk's going to be betting here as well. I have a lot of like range advantage with stuff like aces, ace, king, king, queen. So
agreed. Yeah. So far, so standard.
Yeah, not much to say about that. I think I go for just over 100. Yeah, 110, it looks like. So quarter pot.
Seems fine.
He has a pretty standard call.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, he can probably start even thinking of, probably not with a spade, but I imagine nines with no spade is, I mean, I don't know how the Nick game changes stuff, but in general, I imagine nines, no spade is a fold. Maybe nines with a spade, he has to peel one, but it's probably already getting close on a king high board specifically.
But yeah, I think first quarter pot, he should be continuing with all those pocket pairs. As I size up, probably folding. I think it does start to get a little bit on the edge. I think specifically pocket nines is an interesting one because my four betting range is going to have a lot of those broadways in it. So he doesn't block a lot of those combos. He doesn't really block any of the like ASX suited combos that I have either. So I think it's pretty reasonable to continue here at least once.
Yeah, it's fine. I mean, yeah, it's just basically a zero EV hand pretty much.
Yeah.
Either way.
And then the turn he checks, and I think I want to be using a larger size here, hoping he has some of those King X combos, possibly a spade draw. Those Ace X combos, I think, will be continuing at some frequency. So something like Ace Queen now that he's picked up a gut shot, although I think that starts to get a little thin. Obviously, his medium pairs are probably just going to be folding regardless. So I think I should just try to maximize my value versus some of his bigger hands.
Yeah, agreed.
I go 400 here, which about 2/3, 60%, just fold. And I show the pocket fives because we do have to show our hand for the nit game. So get rid of my nit button and take this one down.
Yeah, Michael's furious at you right now.
Yeah, a little bit. He was like, why didn't I just shove pre? Open up a pretty one under the gun with the ace queen suited here. Gage makes the call. 9-8 offsuit. Not quite expected, a little bit wide. JFail calling here on the button with the suited ace. I think that's fine. And we're going to go three ways to the flop. Not the greatest flop for me. I think this is probably just going to be a pure check for me, multi-way. I guess there's some merit to just betting here as I do have like six live cards often to the best hand. But I think with no back doors, I'm probably just going to be checking this one.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. I would just say, I mean, just the way Gage checked his hand, it's like he is so disinterested at this point. But anyway, just a minor point. But yeah, Gage pretty much never has anything when he checks like that, I don't think.
Yeah, that's fair. I think that's a good read for sure.
I mean, it helps that I can see 9-8 off. It also helps when you can read the board. But
it does check around, and we see the Jack of Diamonds on the turn. Again, everyone just kind of quickly checks. I think in general, this would hit a decent amount of their ranges. I would expect to see some of those Jack X Broadway kind of hands, just given the action pre-flop and on the flop. But obviously, when it checks around here, I think they're much more likely to have either other Broadways or Ace High here. I think a lot of the pairs we would have seen a bet from at this point, I mean, I don't know. It just feels like pocket sevens, pocket eights, those style of hands bets already. Something like fives, fours has a gut shot and wants to Nile. And then, yeah, the Jack X is just going to be betting here on the turn.
Yeah, I mean, the only hand, maybe a hand like ace deuce suited might check twice. But yeah, I mean, you have got way more equity than you ever have any right to have given the hand you have. But yeah, you're ahead like 8, 9 times out of 10.
The river is the five of hearts. Don't think this really changes anything. Obviously, something like ace five, ace four, maybe. Although I think like ace four, pocket fours, those style of hands. Again, the six five, the fives, all that stuff, I think is just betting for like denial or as a bluff. One of the previous two streets, and they've just been very happy to check it down. So,
Yeah, agreed.
I check here. I think I have enough showdown value that I just want to get to the river with ace high, and Gage decides to lead here, or sorry, not lead, but bet $30. Kind of an interesting spot. If he did have a 5x combo, I don't expect him to be using a large size if he does bet. Probably just checking that back, especially on a four straight card. Like we said earlier, a lot of those stronger hands I would have expected to see a bet from already.
Yeah, agreed. I mean, it's very easy because we can see his hand, but it's just like you say, it's so hard to think. It's so hard for him to have a value hand here, given the way he's checked and given, like you say, the sizing he's using and the fact that he'd found some kind of value bet, protection bet with a 5x or 4x hand at some point. So it seems like a good spot to call. Very easy seeing 9-8 off.
Yeah, for sure. But I do make it the call.
Oh,
So,
nice. Good to see.
pretty happy with this one.
Yeah. Yeah, love that. I think that's really, really, really nice hand.
All right, we're gonna get some more interesting ones here coming. Kamikaze opens this one with King Jack of Hearts from early position. I think in general he's gonna probably have a slightly wider range. He's pretty active. Obviously, King Jack of Hearts is more than reasonable to open. Then I think I'm probably supposed to just primarily be folding these style of hands, but at the time, suited king looks good to me. I'm on the button, and I think I can play profitably in position here.
Yeah, agreed. We've got those VPIP stats coming at the end as well, so we can't be too low. So, yeah,
Yeah, we
I
need to
think
be active,
calling a
or
three,
they'll kick us off the stream.
yeah,
Not
calling or three betting, it all seems fine. And folding.
a massive size either. $30 with the straddle out there, so.
How bad can it be?
How bad
Not
can it
very.
be? Interesting flop here. We do flop top pair, backdoor flush draw in position, and Kamikaze flops the overs and the backdoor straight to go along with his heart flush draw. And he decides to check this one. I'm an advocate for checking a lot more out of position in these type of scenarios. Probably a little bit less so when you're opening early position and you have a very strong range. I think playing a lot of these hands as a check raise makes a lot of sense, especially if he thinks I'm going to be float betting quite a bit.
Yeah, agreed.
Then I think when it gets checks to me, I think I have a pretty clear value bet most of the time.
Yeah, I think so. You hadn't, I mean, I'm sure in theory you'll mix in some check, but it seems like you mostly want to bet. So yeah,
Yeah.
seems good.
There I go with 60, and he is a very active player, and he decides to put us in a pretty tough spot here, and he raises it to 280, so pretty large size over my $60 bet. Obviously, like I said, I think he's going to have a lot of those heart draws. I think he would be doing this with hands like Jack 10 as well. So some of those hands that have like overs and a back door. Obviously, he has a lot of these stronger pairs as well. I think my specific combo probably just plays as a call here, especially in position with the backdoor flush draw. And I also don't
Yeah.
block as many of his like check raise bluffs, as I do think some of his like ace high, king high is probably going to be playing more of a call or a fold.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I think it's just a call. I really like his line, by the way. I
Yeah, I
think
do
it,
too.
yeah.
I think it's very well played by him a lot.
Yeah.
Turn is the 10 of diamonds, which is a pretty interesting card. Obviously, 7-8 looms large. But again, I think he does check raise here with some of his like Jack 10, Queen 10. He's going to hit a pair here. He obviously has the 10 of hearts as well. But I think for a lot of his value range, but like his over pairs and stuff, he's not going to really be loving this card too much.
No, I think specific hand I'd probably quite like a pot size bet from him, but
Sure, picking up the straight draw as well.
yeah, but I agree with your overall analysis.
So I guess two questions here. So he does decide to check. If he bets, are we continuing with our hand? I think it's pretty tough to continue here. I'm probably folding versus a continuing, at least for a large sizing. And then I guess second question is facing a check, is there any merit in betting my hand? Inclination is no, as he does have some of those stronger pocket pairs. Then he's gonna have some of those bluffs. I guess I'm folding out some equity, but for the most part, I think I'm only getting called by better.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I agree with both those things. I think probably facing a big bet equilibrium, you'd have some kind of an indifferent hand, but I imagine even though given that we saw his check raise, this might not apply to this exact player, but I imagine the average sort of 2-5 live game, people are going to be under bluffing when they check raise barrel. So yeah, I'd like the fold in general. And then it seems like a clear check to me on the turn. Like you say, given that he can still have overpairs and then, yeah, bluffs that might want to check raise. So it seems good.
Cool. River is the four of diamonds, which really doesn't change much. And he checks here, and I decide to just check back. I mean, I think it's kind of the same as the turn. I don't think I really get value from too many worse hands. Obviously, his range weakens a little bit. He probably has less of the overpair style of hands. But for the most part, I think, like, it's just hard to get value. It's like has to be, like, something like queen nine, maybe jack nine specifically. I'm losing to hands like ace nine still, and all of his, like, 10x of hearts slash jack 10 style of hands that had backdoor.
Yeah. But improved, yeah.
So
I think you've got a clear check.
Okay.
Yeah, I wonder if he could have jammed the river. I imagine that would have been pretty effective. Obviously, with seeing your hand.
Yeah, I mean, I think he can. I think his specific combo, I don't know if it makes too much sense. Yeah. He just has like the worst possible blockers. It seems like he blocked literally all the draws that didn't come in. So.
Agreed. Yeah, I agree.
But it would have definitely put me in a tough spot for sure. Right, this one, I open the hijack with King 10 offsuit, and we are on another round of the knit game. I believe we're at the $300 knit tax now, so punishes you a little bit more. And we're going to play another one against Karmakazi here, and it looks like Mo as well. I'm surprised to not see Karmakazi 3-bet here. I would expect him to like 3-bet a lot more with hands like Ace 9 offsuit here. Maybe the ace nine suited style of hands calling a little bit more, but I think he is incentivized to see flops here.
Yeah, with a knit game.
And then pretty good flop for me with the king 9-4. I think I probably do want to be betting here, especially with the knit game. I think they're going to have a lot more king x combos and some of those other weaker pairs, probably a few more of the club draws. I'd expect all the broadways to be there. So I think there's a ton of draws, a ton of worse hands. So I think bet makes a lot of sense here just for mostly value.
How aggressive do you perceive that these players will be through the probe and barrel lines? Like, do you think with the knit game on there would like just take some crazy hand, like, I don't know, 10-8 or something and just barrel it twice? Or do you think,
you know, that's a good point. I think both these players are probably capable of doing something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think either betting or check is fine. Obviously, the more passive they are, the better the bet becomes, and the more likely they're to sort of just go mad, then sure. The better check is. But yeah, I have no strong views.
I think I sized up a little bit, yeah, $80, just because I think there's just a ton of draws here and just worse King X combo. So multi-way, yeah. Generally going to be using smaller sizes, but I think this board merits a slightly larger size. And then yeah. Karmakazi does call here. I think he would be aggressive with a decent amount of his draws here, but not all of them. So I do expect him to primarily have King X combos here and 9X combos.
Yeah. How do you think he plays? I mean, I guess the fact he calls Ace 9 off preflop means he'd probably be calling a hand like King Jack, King Queen off as well, presumably. At least
yeah,
sometimes.
I think it's going to be a mix from him. King Queen probably 3-bets a little bit more, but I did think it was possible that he had some of the stronger King X combos for sure. He is pretty active, but I think with the knit game, I think he'll be flatting those sometimes. I don't know. Player behind, it's kind of a weird spot.
Yeah.
But he's definitely going to continue here, I think, in the knit game as well. With all of his draws, I just don't know how many he's going to be playing as a raise versus a call.
Yeah.
I guess if he has, yeah, I don't know. Probably more incentivized to raise something like the Jack 10 with a club or something like that. I don't know, but
yeah.
Turn here facing a check. I think for the most part, my hand's still a pretty strong value hand here. He definitely could have something like the King 8 or the 9-8, but for the most part, I think that range that called flop is still going to be calling turn. There's weaker King X, 9X combo, stuff like that. I think he's going to be a little stickier too with 4X combos, especially with all the straight draws and the flush draw out there.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think your hand can just go either way. Yeah. Obviously, the benefits of betting and that he's going to call a wider range probably with the knit game on. And then the benefits of checking is that it gives him a chance to bluff all of the draws that are still currently missing. Yeah, I mean, yeah, I have no strong preference. Betting seems good. I mean, particularly given that we saw him give up the King Jack river in the last hand, probably slight preference to betting.
Go for 225, so a little bit larger. I think I am going to be barreling here a lot with my draws too, so I think it makes even more sense for me to definitely be continuing here with some of my weaker value hands.
Yeah.
And the river is the eight of clubs. I think kind of an interesting one. I guess it really depends on how many of his flush draws are going to be calling flop and turn, probably a little bit less so with the large sizing. Obviously, he can have the king x of clubs, but he can no longer have the 8x of clubs. Yeah, so I guess I still have a relatively strong value hand. I guess I'm a little bit scared of hands like king jack still, something like that. Yeah, I don't know how much single 8x combos he has, but he definitely has a few flushes.
Yeah, he can't really have 8x. If it was like the 8 of diamonds, he could have like 8x of clubs, but it's like really hard for him to have an 8, particularly as you sized up on the flop. So, yeah, like you say, we're not worried about that. In theory, I imagine it's quite hard for him to have a flush as well, because obviously he can call like ace x of clubs, king x of clubs on the turn.
Right.
And he can definitely have king x of clubs for sure. But then at the ace x of clubs, I mean, maybe he's 3-betting more pre because the net game. So he probably doesn't have loads and loads of flushes. Yeah, I mean, it feels close on the river. Maybe, I mean, I think if there's no net game, I think you have a pretty standard check back. But I wonder if he's going to be more incentivized to call with just like basically any pair. Feels close.
He probably is calling a little bit more in the knit game. And if we think he's defending a little bit wider, like some more king x and possibly more 9x, which we do see with the ace 9 offsuit, probably does merit maybe like a block bet sizing.
Yeah, it seems close. I've got no objection with that.
I guess the other thing too, though, is like, both of us have a nit button, and I guess part of my thought process was as well, like, I can check back here. I don't have to face a raise. I really don't want to face a raise, and I want to get rid of my nit button. A raise would be pretty disastrous.
I think the standard is to check back for what it's worth. Okay. I think it's really close, but I would check back.
Okay. I thought it was close. I had the 10 of clubs, so I think that incentivizes me to bet slightly, but I don't know. I did go with the check back.
Yeah, I thought you were angling towards betting, but yeah, I think the standard is to check.
All right, the next hand, J-Phil opens it in the cutoff with King 10 offsuit. And Trulp getting a little frisky here with the 7 deuce off. Decides to 3-bet it to 125. They are...
I assume you don't have the 7 deuce game.
We are not playing the 7 deuce game.
Okay, cool. Sorry, I interrupted you.
Yeah, no, you're fine. They are two of the last three with a nit button at this point, so they are both incentivized to be pretty aggressive here. I look down at pocket threes in the big blind. I think for the most part, I'm just always going to be folding this hand. These players are both pretty deep with me, and like I said, they're both incentivized to be pretty aggressive here, so I do expect them to barrel off a lot on flops and turn. But I thought I had like better implied odds if I did hit a set compared to most instances of this.
Maybe. It feels like a fault to me, but I have no experience playing the knit game, so I'm happy to playing these players. I'm happy to trust your judgment.
Yeah, like, I mean, like I think I do fold almost every time, but I decided to call this one. And J Phil calls behind. What?
Let me see. Do we flop a set? Do we get ultimate reward?
We do flop a set. Unfortunately, there's not too much going on for my opponents. That quickly checks around. And I think given the nature of their quick checkbacks and the four of hearts not really doing much on the turn, I decide to check again.
Yeah.
It checks around again.
They are so disinterested, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. I guess the question here is like what to do on the river. I decided to go with a bet, hoping that they did have one of those 9x combos or like a weaker pair that was just like, you know, it checked around. I'm just going to bluff catch. I don't think if they haven't bluffed at this point that they're going to be bluffing too much here on the river.
100% agree. Yep. Neither of those people look like two people who are ready to start bluffing.
Yeah. I just really thought that they were going to be bluffing a lot more because they're like final people of the knit game. But
yeah,
is what it is.
I'm not impressed that 7 deuce is a 3-bet pre and then not had at least one stab on the flop.
No, what's up with that? Mo opens this one up from early position with queen jack offsuit. J Phil calls. So I think this is shortly after the pocket threes as both these players still have their nit buttons. I look down at a premium and decide to 3-bet here with the ace king offsuit. And Gage also has the final nip button of, so I guess final four with the nip buttons. And he also has ace king. And he just decides to 5-bet rip it in.
Yeah. Seems good.
I mean, I'm not like thrilled here, but I think I just have like a pretty easy call.
Yeah.
I don't think there's much to say about this one.
No. I mean, I'd fold if there was no nit game.
Yeah, so I guess he 3-bet pre, so I called 4-bet and then called 5-bet by Gage. But yeah, I think given the nature, I think I just have to call.
Yeah, and you're pretty happy to see that result.
Yeah, perfectly fine. I'm perfectly fine flipping too, but yeah, I mean, dead money in there, so good for both of us.
Yeah. No clubs.
We both hit the nuts on the top board, but yeah, just chopping it.
Nice. $85 earned.
Yeah, it all adds up.
Mm-hmm.
Trulp doing Trulp things and opening random cards. So he opens to 35 with 7-6 offsuit. And I think against his range, I have a pretty easy 3-bet here with the ace-queen offsuit.
Yeah. Mark looked like he did not want to fold 9-8 of clubs there.
I don't think he did, yeah. Bobby decides to call here, and Mo looks down at pocket aces in the straddle.
Yeah, this doesn't bode well.
Doesn't bode well. He makes it 400, I believe.
Small.
425, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, that's reasonable. Yeah, 4-bet. Yeah, that seems fine.
So kind of a weird spot for me. Probably just generally folding here. I will say we're down to, I think it was 2 people left on the nit game, maybe 3. But Mo does still have his nit button. Mo generally is 3-betting and 4-betting very wide. And I think we both know at this point that Trulp's opening range is basically any 2 cards. So yeah. I'm going to be 3-betting lighter, and I expect he's going to be 4-betting lighter.
Yeah, this is such a weird spot. I mean, if you had like 1900, or if you were 1900 effective, you'd probably just have a jam here, right? I guess you're too deep to jam.
And yeah, I did think about jamming as an option, but it felt like we were a little bit too deep.
Yeah, it's a really weird spot, but I think you probably have a mandatory call. But I mean, I'm out of my element here. I have no idea how these. Yeah.
Do you think there's merit to 5-betting for a smaller size?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, ace queen off is usually like that and ace 5 suited are usually the hands to go for. Yeah, I mean, I didn't consider it as an option, but I think there is. Is that what we go for?
Yeah, it is what I go for. What do you think about sizing? I don't think I have to go too large.
No, like, would you go like a grand, 1,100 or something?
Yeah, I go 1,000 exactly, just under 2.5x. It gets really awkward with this like stack to pot ratio, but it feels like that's a size where I have fold equity, but I also can fold my hand if I need to.
Yeah. Yeah, I like it. How do you think Mo reacts with like his more marginal squeezes? Like say if he had king, queen, king, jack suited here.
Yeah, I mean, he might be continuing with like the king, queen suited, those style hands. I look pretty strong here though. So I think he would probably just be folding all those hands. I expect him to continue with his stronger pocket pairs. And then, yeah, maybe like ace-king continues here. I think probably king-queen continues, king-queen suited. And then like ace-queen suited. But yeah, it's going to be a very narrow range.
Yeah. And what do you think he should do with his exact hand here? Just flat?
Yeah, I think in his shoes, I'm probably flatting here. I think 6-bet looks just like way too strong. So I think I'm just going to be playing my hand as a trap. Obviously, like people aren't 5-bet bluffing too often. So it's probably fine to just put it in as well.
Yeah, true.
I don't think it really matters. I mean, with him having the nit button, maybe he wants to shove here a little bit more often. I guess it depends. If he's shoving like all of his ace king, he should probably be shoving like aces too.
Yeah.
But I think flat is probably what I would do in his shoes.
Yeah, I think same. I think, yeah, but he can't go wrong really, can he?
I so rarely 6-bet. I think it just doesn't make that much sense because like ranges are so narrow. I just pretty much just flat here every time.
Are we going to get queen, queen, deuce?
Almost.
No. No.
So just a garbage flop. I mean, I think there's a lot of boards I'm range betting, but I think this is like one of those that I probably don't as much, but I'm not really sure like in a 5-bet pot because it's kind of unexplored territory for the most part. I think in a 4-bet pot, he's going to have hit this a little bit stronger probably, and I'm just going to be checking this one back. But I mean, even in a five bet pot here, I think he has some of those like pocket tens, pocket nines, pocket eights, maybe.
I agree.
Yeah, I don't know.
If there's a board to check, it seems like this or like maybe 8-10 jack or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, you've got a pretty hopeless hand as well. So if you're going to build a checking range, I'm sure your hand's going to get in it.
Yeah. I mean, not much going on for my hand. I don't even have a backdoor flush or anything like that, or like a gut shot or anything. Then I'm pretty much just done.
Pretty well.
What?
Getting this board, haven't you? You've ran pretty well getting this board. At least it's not a king high board.
Yeah. True. King high, ace high, queen high board. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's an awkward spot for Mo as well.
Yeah, he's got just over pot back. He decides to jam here. I don't know what you think about that. I thought in the moment that was kind of a weird hand or weird spot for him to jam, just because I think it's so hard for me to call here. And then it's like, if I do, like, I see his hand because of the Nick game and he has like aces, no diamond, but it's just like, if I do call here, I think he's just like almost dead most of the time, unless I have exact, I mean, obviously we talked about me checking a lot, but I'm going to have like flushes here and like possibly like something like pocket tens or nines at some frequency. I guess he's getting value if I have like pocket kings, pocket queens, pocket jacks, especially with a diamond. So maybe
yeah.
It's fine.
I mean, it feels okay. I mean, the honest truth is that I have absolutely no idea how this like Nick game five bet pot dynamic plays out. I mean, I guess jam can't be too bad. He probably expects that you're going to bet probably more often than you are on this board, like because population probably would still bet a lot, whereas probably you're finding a few more checks on this specific board.
Sure.
And yeah, you're just not going to, he probably just thinks, yeah, you're just not going to fold any kind of pair with a diamond.
Yeah.
It's probably fine. And it's, I mean, and I don't, and I imagine there's an element of, I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but like an element of wanting to get rid of the nit button. This is like, there are some incredibly bad rivers for his hand as well.
Yeah, like protects any, versus like any of the diamond X or an eight or a jack, something like that.
Yeah. I mean, I just don't know. I wouldn't feel qualified to be honest to give an opinion, but it's probably fine.
Sure. And not much else to say after that. I have a pretty easy fold, so.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty good run out. All things being considered in the end. Queen, yeah. Queen, deuce would have been better.
Sure. All right, so Jay Phil decides to limp this one. Michael opens the hijack, and I look down at ace-jack suited, the cutoff. And again, I think I just have a pretty clear 3-bet here, especially with the Nick game.
Yeah.
Mark just keeps getting...
These folds are like, painful for Mark.
I know, he just doesn't want to fold them. He has like those very marginal hands.
Yeah, Bobby Jones is not going to fold, however.
No, he actually goes with the old 4-bet. So good on him. I think I like that more than the 3-bet.
Yeah,
betting.
I do.
He saw how well pocket fives worked for me earlier. And I think my specific hand, especially in position here, I just have a pretty clear call. Ace-jack off, I'm probably just folding, but ace-jack suited just seems too strong.
Yeah. I mean, if we knew, there were probably arguments for jamming. Now we know what Bobby's doing, but you probably didn't know that at the time. If you knew he was this wide. But yeah.
This is wider than I expect. He did talk about how he wished he 4-bet earlier with some of his weaker pocket pairs when we had a similar situation. but it doesn't mean he's always doing it, yeah. So I make the call. And surprisingly, Gage, who flatted the cold 3-bet, decides to call this cold 4-bet as well.
But looking for hearts.
Yeah, looking for hearts or straights. I think his hands just appear fold, but we're playing the Nick game.
Yeah, I saw this hand on stream. I think you ended up just c-betting and taking this down, if I remember rightly.
Yeah.
Can't even remember.
Yeah, so checks to me. I mean, I think there's definitely merit from Bobby's perspective for sure to just c-bet here for a small size and push out a lot of equity. I don't know. Like the Queen X definitely hits my range pretty hard, but
yeah,
I also have
ace,
stuff
queen,
like
king,
this.
Queen suited stuff.
And then with the nit button, I just decided to go with a small size here. I got backdoor royal flush draw, which is important.
backdoor royal flush draw, backdoor trips draw.
Yeah, I think Gage is probably supposed to continue here. If you're gonna cold call a 4-bet, you probably want to just call here. But I look pretty strong too, so like I get him not being comfortable.
I think it's a call.
Yeah, I don't think Bobby can continue here, so we pick up this one.
Yeah, nice. Did you pain them when you showed it them?
Always a little bit, yeah. Bobby was mad because he didn't see bet. Premium.
Yeah, makes change.
Pretty easy call for Gage here, I think. So let's see. Oh, Michael does call in the straddle as well, probably just because of the Nick game.
Yeah.
Not my favorite flop, but I'm still ahead of most of their hands.
Yeah.
But I think check around or check makes the most sense, and it does check around. Limit some of those better hands, I guess. Expect them.
Get some more visibility, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
Ooh, two of spades appeared
two
there.
Two spades exposed. Still a pretty draw heavy board overall. Michael does check here, and camera's a little off, but I decided to go for a bet size of 130. I think given the nature of the flop, it is more likely that Gage is going to be continuing with some of his pocket pairs. Obviously, diamonds came in. He's going to have some 10x combos, a few straight draws as well, although I think a lot of those are probably betting flop.
Yeah, agreed. I like it. I think that probably, I presume that there'd be a tendency to sort of always bet King X, I mean, which of course would be fine. And probably it seems like a lot of these players are playing their draws relatively passively, so which incentivizes you to bet rather than checks. So yeah, seems good. Like it.
So Gage does make the call. Four of spades comes in, which is just pretty much nothing. And I think I have a pretty clear value bet here, especially if we think he's betting a lot of his King X. Obviously, I block like the King Queen. I think he's going to be re-raising the ace king, so there's not too many strong king x combos that he doesn't bet. So I go for a pretty large sizing here because a lot of the draws do miss. I don't think much has changed, like I said, if he does have those pocket pairs. Same with 10x, so I do expect a crying call from those. Pretty high frequency of the time.
Yep, I like it. I think it's good. I mean, I think this is probably a little bit, in theory, a bit too big, but I think you have more equity in practice than you do in theory, so yeah. I really like it. Another nice hand. Not enough to criticize so far, apart from your cold call with pocket threes, but then you flopped a set. So what do I know?
Backup plans.
Yeah.
So he tanks for a little while, but
he's
does
gonna
make
call,
the
I reckon.
fold.
Oh, he folds. Nice.
Yeah, so good fold by him.
Yeah, I was expecting a call.
Very long tank. He was not happy about it. And I don't know what happens exactly why I opened this hand. We are playing the Nick game.
You've got giddy, haven't you? You've got giddy.
Yeah,
won a few
so
pots.
I got a little out of line on this one, but I opened the 8-7 offsuit. Kamikaze calls pretty wide on the button, and I think J-Phil calls pretty wide in the straddle. I think we had just started the Nick game.
All three of you have absolutely lost your minds there, haven't you? All three of you.
A little bit. I am an advocate for like trying to be a little bit more aggressive probably early on, if anything, in the Nick game, just because like, It's hard to get a hand, but as you get later in the Nick game, it just feels like you get looked up a little bit more. People are like, oh, he has to bluff. But I don't know. I mean, it's a balance for sure.
Yeah. What do we think here? Standard would be to check, but I wonder if you want to go for small bets sometimes.
Yeah, I think it's obviously a good flop. I do have reasonable backdoors here, so I do go for a small sizing. I think my hand gains a lot from denial here.
Yeah. Multiway, especially.
Yeah. So there's just like so many bad turn cards. I mean, obviously, there's like a lot of good turn cards, but it's like even with my back doors, like I'm not thrilled necessarily if a club comes in, right? So,
exactly. Yeah. I mean, getting them to fold a hand like Jack 10 or something is just a massive win, isn't it?
For sure. For sure. And then Kamikaze decides to call here in position. I assume just to steal this because this is pretty
wide.
Yeah,
he's got bad intentions.
Yeah. And we will see those bad intentions here shortly. So heads up to the turn. The turn is the seven of diamonds. So I have the top two pair. So pretty good turn card for me overall. Gives Kamikaze an open ender though. So I continue for 110. I think I do want to be continuing here for the most part. Yeah, I mean, I guess something like 9-10 gets there and 5-4. For the most part, I think he's going to have, you know, some flush draw, some pair plus flush draw, pair plus straight draw style of hands. If he decided not to three bet something like pocket nines, or if he calls with something like pocket fives, I think I gain value from those hands. So I'm ahead of other 8x now. So I think it just makes sense to barrel here.
Seems good to me.
And he decides to put me in a very tough spot here, unfortunately. He
Yeah, I
puts in
really
a
like it from
pretty
him.
sizable raise.
I'm worried he's going to give up the river, but I like his line.
Yeah, I don't think his hand is strong enough to call or has enough equity, so I think raise
No.
makes the most sense, right? So yeah, I
Yeah, I
definitely
mean,
like the
sorry, he should
raise.
obviously fold the flop, but I mean, yeah. Once gets, I mean, I imagine he probably can call with the open ender in position,
Maybe
but
in the overcard.
yeah, but I just like, yeah, wherever you've got the chance to be aggressive, I think it's usually a good option.
What do you think about
And
his
he's gone really
sizing?
po.
Almost a
Well, he's saying he's got a
5x.
really strong hand, right? And you're deep. So, yeah, I like it. I imagine he's not looking to make any kind of thin or merged value ranges. He's basically saying he has a set plus, right?
Yeah, just
So,
completely polarized.
yeah, I like it.
And I just have
And you're in the
a
blender.
mandatory call here, I think, with top two pair.
Yeah.
Don't think
But
there's
yeah,
much merit in jamming as he's so polarized that it's like only better hands or bluffs.
agreed.
A sizable pot on our hands. Interesting river. The four of diamonds. I check to him.
Oh, I really
And
hope he goes for this from
yeah, it's
his
just,
perspective.
yeah, I guess we can see what he does. Pot's 1.145.
He has to be like, I mean, he has to be like all in here, right? I think because his raise with for his range for barreling the turn. Well, let's think about this. So he's basically saying on the turn that he has a set plus.
Right.
You probably don't have that much 5x in your opening pre betting flop betting turn. So probably he, I mean, maybe he wants two sizes. Maybe he can bet like some kind of three quarter size for his sets, and then he wants an all in size for his 10-9. And I think as he has a nine, it seems like a nice hand just for him to just jam it all in, I reckon.
Yeah, I mean, I think overall the overbet makes a lot of sense as played. I'm not sh Yeah, I probably. It's hard for either of us to have too much 5x, I guess. Yeah, I would
He
have
can have
had to.
6-5 for
Yeah,
sure.
I have 6-5, and I might have like pocket fives,
Yeah.
and maybe some
Oh, I don't think.
ace five, especially of clubs. But yeah, there's very few 5x combos.
I don't think you're pocket fives. I don't think you're betting flop and turn with pocket fives.
Yeah, probably not. I don't think it's unreasonable, but yeah,
No.
probably less so. I mean, I am incentivized to be a little bit more aggressive with the Nick game, but yeah, I agree.
Yeah. He can definitely have 6-5 for sure. I
Yeah,
mean,
I think both of us could have 6-5. I think 6-5, I mean,
yeah.
I think 6-5 and fives honestly make a decent amount of sense. And then if I had ace five of spades or ace five of clubs, I think I would be playing my hand similar, but I might just be folding turn two. So I think that limits my 5x even more once he raises the turn.
Yeah. I would have preferred all in from him, but I mean, we have overbet at least, or he has overbet at least.
Yeah, I mean, it's still a pretty significant overbet.
Yeah.
But yeah, so when he overbets here, I wasn't sure how much he's doing this with just 5x combos. Again, like for him to raise turn, there's not too many 5x combos that make sense. To me, it's primarily going to be 5-4, and obviously the 4 reduces that slightly. Also, like I think if he had like 5-4 of clubs, I think he's going to be raising flop a lot. So it's really 5-4 of spades, which also might raise flop a decent amount, and like 5-4 of hearts. And then even then, I don't know if he's using this sizing necessarily with this 5x. I mean, I think it's probably fine, like we said, but for the most part, I think he's really saying that he has 10-9.
Yeah, I agree. He's saying he has 10-9, but also for some reason saying he's not going all in.
Yeah, but I mean, a lot of people just don't use all-in sizings here either, so.
Yeah, fair enough. Fair enough.
I don't think there's too much separation there in practice.
And what did you think about his bluffing range in game? Because it's kind of hard for him to have a bluff, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's really hard. Like, I had like Jack 9 of clubs, maybe, or like any kind of club with a nine, I suppose, makes some amount of sense. But we've seen him give up miss club, miss flush draw on the river when you
Yeah,
have
I mean,
King
I know he
Jack.
gave up the King Jack earlier, but I feel like in general, he is a pretty aggressive player. I definitely think he's capable of bluffing here, and I think he does like a decent amount for what it's worth. Obviously, the sample
Yeah.
size you've seen doesn't really necessarily show that. But yeah, it pretty much has to be like missed club draws. I'm not sure if he's just going for it with like the ace and king high of clubs. I think like last hand is king jack, it made sense to not bet river.
Yeah.
So I think maybe those hands are probably checking back, but I think if he has any weaker clubs, even if he's picked up a pair, so we have like the 8x of clubs possibly, 7x of clubs possibly. He does have the 4x clubs if he does have something like, he does have like 4-3 of clubs, or if he did have ace 4 of clubs. I mean, obviously the ace not as much, but I think he's just turning all those hands into a bluff. I don't think he expects like a weaker pair to be good here. And then I think we have all of the 9x of club combos. Obviously, he's a little bit wider here with like 9-3 of spades, but I think some of the 9x of spades hands as well. So if he did have something like jack 9 of spades that side to float flop, I think it's reasonable that he raises turn as well and plays it like this.
Yeah.
So I think maybe his wide.
So what do you think about your decision?
It's tough. I guess the other hand that he could have as well is something like 9-8 that he turns into a bluff. I think he's capable of that. I don't know if he's necessarily doing that. He would have to raise turn, but I don't think it's impossible. Overall, I mean, obviously there's not a lot of bluffs, but there's just not a lot of value either. I really thought it was primarily going to be 10-9 that he was taking this line with. And I wasn't positive he was taking it with 5x. And even if he was, like we talked about, he really doesn't have too much 5x. I don't think he's raising turn all the time with like 6-5 pocket fives. It's really just 5-4. And it feels like a lot of those 5-4s play aggressively previously, and they're reduced by the river. So it really felt like he had like 4 to 5 combos of value. So I knew he was capable of bluffing here.
I mean, if he only has 4 or 5 combos of value, then he literally only needs to have like 2 combos of bluffs or 3 combos of bluffs, and he's over bluffing.
Yeah. I don't know. I think it's close. I was definitely like in the blender. I tanked for quite a while on this one, I think. I don't know. Like, I guess 5x, if I have it, is going to be a call here. And obviously, but I don't know if like what my best bluff catching hand here is. I have the 8 of clubs, which we said clubs is probably worse, but I think the 8 of clubs specifically matters a little bit less.
I mean, yeah, if you're thinking in terms of bluff catches, I probably think the 7's bad, because I think he's more likely to use a 7 as a bluff than a value hand at this point. I don't think he'd be betting a set for this size in the river. But I probably wouldn't. I mean, I think it's such a unique spot, and it's probably a spot where he's likely to be massively imbalanced either one way or the other. So I think it's probably just a question of like working out whether he's over bluffing or under bluffing, and then making your decision on that basis.
Right. And I will say too, with the Nick game, it's probably leans towards bluffing a little bit more as well. But
yeah.
So I don't know. I do make the call and I am good, but that was a tough one. So I think well played by him overall. Minus maybe the flop call, but I like the aggression.
Yeah, the flop's fold. I love the aggression. I wish he jammed the river, but yeah, I'm a fan of the turn and river playing jammer for sure.
Yeah. That was
I mean, because you don't have to have that hand there either, do you? I mean, you can have lots of other stuff.
I could have like overpairs and stuff, yeah. I'm in a tough spot regardless, right? For the most part.
Yeah. So. Yeah, I like his line. I've been impressed by his play so far.
Yeah, for sure. So this is a splash pot. So I don't know what the pot says. Yeah, so the pot's wrong. There's actually an extra 300 in the middle because we just finished the Nick game.
Do you remember who lost it?
Can't recall, honestly. I want to say Gage, but I'm not sure. It might be Bobby because he's pretty short stacked.
So I think I just saw 6-4 offsuit find a call.
Yeah. So obviously, garbage hand. I am in this straddle, and there's multiple callers in front of me. Like I said, there's 300 more in the middle than what the pot says. So the pot is 680 after Gage calls. So I just figured I'm getting like relatively good odds to try to just hit some garbage bullshit hand and get paid.
Fair enough with the splash pot. Yeah, fair enough.
Yeah, if it wasn't a splash pot, I'm never calling, but $300 is quite a significant jump in the pot size. So yeah, I don't think they adjusted on the screen throughout this hand, so just imagine there's another 300 in there.
Cool.
Flop a pair.
Flop a pair. Hard to make a pair in Texas Hold'em.
And Bobby uses a pretty small size here. I think overall, obviously, his stack to pot's kind of awkward, but I think he goes larger than I thought. I guess this size is like $200.
Such a weird hand.
Yeah, 225.
Not sure what Mo's thinking about.
I'm not sure either, but Mo folds, Michael folds. I don't know, you're just folding in my shoes. The pot's $905.
Don't know. I mean, I think I get the sense that you've played with Bobby Jones before quite a lot, right? So, I mean, you're probably better judged to say than I am. I mean, do you think he's got Jack 10?
I think it's possible, but he might just be jamming that too on the flop. I mean, the stack to pot is so awkward. Like, maybe I'm supposed to just be folding because there's just like not that much value in my hand, unimproved.
Yeah. And you've got Gage behind, right, as well.
Yeah, I have Gage behind. I didn't expect Gage to have too strong of a hand generally. He just like limp called pre-flop, but yeah.
And he'd probably lead a decent amount. I mean, it feels like a fold, doesn't it, in truth?
Yeah.
It's 200 to win 900. So you only need like...
Yeah.
I mean, it's so hard because it's such a bloated pot. But you're not going to realize all your equity because, Bobby Jones is shoving every turn pretty much, right? So you've got five outs once.
Yeah, I guess my thought process too was like, if I had like queen four or something like that, I think I'm just folding like every time. But the 6-4 just felt like I could pick up some equity on the turn. But yeah, it's probably just a fold. I don't know.
Yeah, because I mean, even if say the turn's a five, which would give you a gut shot, right? Then and he jams, you probably still got a fold anyway. I mean, you even in it.
Yeah, I mean, pot's 11.50 at that time, and he jams for like 435.
Oh yeah, so maybe you're not folding, but yeah, it feels like a fold. I mean, it doesn't feel like the worst call in the world, but my guess is it's a fold. But it's hard to say because this is a pretty unique spot, right?
Yeah, I think I'm probably supposed to fold as well, but put in the call.
You're gonna bink it. I know. I can feel you're gonna bink.
Gage calls behind. So we're gonna go three ways to the turn. So pot's even more bloated at this point. Turn is the seven of diamonds, giving me that open ender. I just check. I don't think there's much else to say about that. Gage quickly checks, which makes sense with his specific hand, and Bobby checks as well. River two of hearts. I guess if Bobby Jones was deeper, I think there's some merit to betting here. With the pot at 13.55, I think if he has any value hand, he's just calling. I guess I push out some of Gage's value, but I don't know.
Yeah.
At this point, I was just like, I'm just going to check it down.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I agree with your thoughts entirely. There's stuff you can do at a deeper SBRs, but not when Bobby's got 0.4.
Kind of a weird spot, but I don't know. I probably don't win too often, but I don't know. I just think I'm getting called way too often. That there's just not enough merit in betting. There's no point in pushing Gage out.
You can maybe check jam if Gage bets Bobby folds, but yeah, other than that, I think you're done.
Yeah, sure. And it just checks around and Bobby does pull this one in. So probably just a fold on the flop, but that's all right.
Yeah. Final hand.
Yep, this is the final hand. Bobby's going to limp, and J-Phil's going to open it up to 85 in the cutoff. I think pretty just easy defending the big blind with 8-7 suited. And finally gives Mark a chance to get in with his 10-9 suited here. And it looks like Gage continues as well in the double straddle with pocket fours. So, and then, yeah, I think Bobby just has a call here after everyone else calls. So now we got a Houston heads up.
Yeah, we do. I think we could have... Would it been a squeeze?
We could have squeezed. I've been squeezing J-Phil a lot. I thought I'd give him a break.
Spicy flop.
Yeah, very spicy for me with the open ender and the backdoor flush. And Mark decides to lead out here really small. These donk bets are really going to be top pair most of the time, but kind of an interesting sizing from him and J-Phil making a call. I don't expect J-Phil to have as many over pairs. But I make a sizable raise given his $60 with the open ender. I don't know if you think there's more merit in calling there, or if probably just indifferent.
No, I like the check raise. I was just interested that Marcus is called super quick there. Yeah. He's given no consideration to fold or raise, which is like we're honing in on this. I mean, basically the exact kind of hand he's got.
Right, very much top pairs with the donk and quick call. Turn's a very spicy one.
It is.
So I obviously picked up the flush draw to go along with my straight draw. I mean, obviously barreling here is perfectly fine. I just have so much equity. I think he's going to have a lot of 9x combos as played. I don't think those are folding, so I don't think I have really any fold equity against those. Obviously, I'm going to continue versus a bet, but I wasn't sure if there was like too much reason to necessarily bloat the pot. Although, again, it just like doesn't matter too much. But pair board as well.
Yeah, I agree. It's a really unique spot because not only because his like betting line, but just everything he's done suggests he has a nine.
Yeah.
Which, yeah, that's why I think I like your line. I think you're going to have to donk a lot of rivers, though, when you get there. Particularly if it's the flush competing river, you can probably check a five.
If he bets and I call.
Yeah, if you go check call. Yeah.
Yeah. So I do check this one. I would expect him to be betting a lot of his 9x here on the turn. But he does check this one back.
Yeah. I would be so confused in game.
I do get there with the straight. So kind of a weird line by him. Yeah, I don't.
So what do we think he has? I mean, one hand that would make sense for his line to like donk and then very quickly call would be a hand like 5-4, or or also another 7-8.
Yeah, so I think 5-4, 7-8 make a lot of sense. I think 9x is still looming pretty large.
Yeah.
I guess if he doesn't squeeze like a hand like pocket tens, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would say primarily 9x still, even though he checked back turn. I mean, it's interesting check back by him, but like the donk bet quick call is just so often top pair in these spots.
Yeah, agreed, I guess. Yeah, and we just think that takes precedence over the turn check. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I mean, that's my inclination, but it's hard to say for sure. 8-7 obviously makes a lot of sense, like you said, and 5-4 as well.
Yeah. So then what do we think the best size is?
Yeah, I think we definitely want to go for value, especially against the hand or the ranges that we've just said. I think probably sizable, probably around 75%. Maybe can go a little bit larger if he has mostly 9x combos, though.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like I really don't like 75%, I don't think. I think that might be one of the worst options.
Okay.
Because I think, I mean, I don't know this kind of player type, but I think it's possible he would call a check raise, which would, I think, because I don't think he's going to check back a nine twice. So if he does have a nine, he's definitely betting. And I think there's a good chance he's not folding to a check raise.
That's fair.
And I also think if you overbet, he's not folding either.
Sure.
I mean, I don't think anybody's ever checking back a nine to fold.
Yeah, I think overbet probably makes the most sense. I guess I would. Yeah. Is there any chance that he has a full house? Probably not as played, right?
I mean, possibly, but you don't have to have 100% equity to overbet. Like, and then maybe if we think he does still have boats, then that makes check raise worse. So maybe, maybe we're landing on overbet being better. Because I think he might still have some full houses. He could still have pocket sixes. Like, we couldn't completely rule it out. But
yeah, sixes or threes. Yeah.
But I think you definitely have 90% equity here.
Yeah. No, and then I think I agree with you. I think overbet probably is the correct line.
Because, I mean, when you are overbetting, his hand is actually a bluff catcher, but it's very hard for people to realize that, like, a nine here in this spot would be a bluff catcher. So I think that's the kind of spot you, like, want to capitalize on, that people not realizing the difference in their absolute and relative hand strength. And, yeah, go something like 1,500 to 2,000, probably.
Yeah, and I think given the check-check on the turn, he's even more likely to call some of those 9x combos as well.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I mean, imagine folding a nine. Imagine like trapping a nine and then folding on a five.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I think those are all very good points. Yeah, so it looks like I do 750, so about 75%, and he quickly calls. So yeah, I think overbet's definitely the size I wanted to use.
Yeah. Because he's not going to call with like 5-4 anyway, is he?
Right.
Yeah.
He was very surprised to see my hand, but he didn't even realize I had a flush draw. So he was like, oh my gosh, you got there with just the five out as the out. I mean, the 10 gives him the straight. I was like, I had the flush draw. He's like, oh, okay.
You check called the flop though. So it's, I mean, it'd be perfectly reasonable for you to not have a flush draw considering you check the turn.
Yeah, no, I know. So yeah, that was the final hand. So maybe could have got a little bit of value off for that one at the end. But I think overall, I played pretty well this session.
Yeah, I think you played great.
Just over 5K.
Really, really. Yeah, I think you paid really, really, really well. Very impressed.
Thank you. Appreciate it. And thanks for reviewing those hands with me.
No problem.
I know it took a little chunk out of your day to do that, so I appreciate it.
No, I had a lot of fun. Yeah, it was really, really good fun. Thank you.
All right, buddy. Well, it was good seeing you, and I hope you have a good rest of your trip. Definitely let us know when you're passing through Texas. We'll play some poker.
Cool. All right, then, speak to you soon.
All right, see you, buddy.
Cheers. Thank you. Bye-bye.